morning, girls. I wish everyone are in the home and in the safe mode. Once again, we are starting with a fresh and our subject chapter. That is, we are starting with our full-fledged subject. In the earlier class, I discussed with you what is commerce, what is the career in commerce, how an intermediate syllabus is being divided in commerce, that is commerce part A, accountancy part B, what are the things which are covered in part A and what are the things which are covered in part B, accountancy. So we have a rough outline of our subject in the earlier class. Now we are going to put a step in our full-fledged subject. We are starting today with our commerce, that is part A in a question paper. In a question paper, commerce part A will be asked you for 50 marks. So the syllabus roughly are given as a contents. So here itself I will tell you how much the weightage you are going to get in each and every unit with the chapter. So concepts of business and activities, here the weightage is 2 marks plus 5 marks. Totally we are going to get 7 marks in this unit. Here we have weightage 2 marks plus 5 marks plus 10 marks. Totally 17 marks you are going to get from there. Then we are having here also 2 marks plus 5 marks plus 10 will give 17 marks weightage. That means you will get one question here for 2 marks from these two topics and one question you will get for 5 marks, that is for the total weightage covered in the unit 1 is 7 marks. Whereas in this, definitely one question, two questions you will get. Alternate choice, that means if the examiner is asking two questions from these three chapters, you are going to get 20 marks here. If an examiner is asking only one question from these three, then you are going to get only 10 marks. So we will put here 2. That is 27 marks. Totally 2 essay questions will be asked, very very important for our annual exam and also for further studies this unit. So 2 questions of 10 marks each, 20 and 5 marks, 1 question, 2 marks, 1. Then coming to here, 1 question they will ask you for 10 marks compulsorily. And 5 marks 1, 2 marks 1. Then going for the other topics also, here there is a chance of 2 marks plus 5 marks plus 10, totally 17 marks. So in the others also same like that. Now we will start with our concepts of business. So our concepts of business, before we start, so little bit fresh up what we have done in the earlier class. You know all social studies. Social studies study with your citizenship, studies with your social being. That is nothing but man is always interdependent. That means a man always has needs and wants. He cannot lead the life individually. That means from the stage of birth to death, always a human being has to depend for satisfying his needs or wants on someone else. That is example, a worker working in an organization always has to work with someone so that in return what he is going to get, he he will use the income for satisfying his basic needs. A farmer cultivating the land in the fields will produce the paddy and he will try to sell that paddy in the market. When he gets some return from that produce, he is going to satisfy his wants or needs. Suppose a person wants to move from one place to another place, he has to select or choose any one of the transport mode like either buses, trains, cars or anything else. So when he is going in the transport, he has to pay the fare for using the services of the transport. So every person is not fully able to lead the life individually. Always his search or always his ability will be to how to satisfy the demands or the desires which are going to take place in his mind or in his heart, how to satisfy them, how to fulfill his desires. So that desires will give a place for our subject commerce. So man is a social animal, so his needs, to satisfy his needs and wants, he will be engaged in performing or in discharging various types of services, which includes production, distribution or circulation or exchange of goods and services in order to maximize or in order to satisfy his needs, he is going to earn income. That we will call as a human activity. Okay, suppose if you see wants and needs, wants are nothing but the desires which you get in your will, the desires which are going to take place in your mind, which you need to satisfy yourself. Needs means those essential things which are compulsorily should have with us so that we can lead our life. So to complete our both the things, meaning will be same, but we use interchangeably between the wants and needs. So we will call that as human activity. Human activity means nothing but all those activities which are undertaken by a person to satisfy his basic needs, we will call that as a human activity. Okay. So once again, now first we are starting with want or needs. Want or needs means every person cannot lead his life, he cannot satisfy his desires, his willingness, his choices or his needs or important satisfactions or desires which are going to take place in his mind or in his will, which has to be satisfied with the help of taking someone. So to satisfy your wants or to satisfy your needs, you need to earn some money or you need to perform some activity or you need to discharge certain duties, which in return you are going to earn some money. That means to satisfy your basic needs. What will be the basic needs? Every person will be busy in performing some duty or other duty in order to satisfy his want or desire. Example, you take a teacher. A teacher will come to school or college to tell the teachings or to tell the subject. In return, she is going to get some income. We will call that as salary. A driver means a bus driver or a car driver. वेरी वेल वेरी बिजी इन ड्राइविंग द व्हीकल. When he drives the vehicle, he is called as busy in doing one activity. For what reason or for what purpose he is performing that activity? In order to earn some income through which he is going to satisfy his wants or needs. A singer will be busy in singing the songs because he is going to get a remuneration by doing such activity. A postman is going to get income when he moves from one house to another house to post the letters. He is going to get a salary from the government for performing such activity. Okay, a father always will be busy in going to office, discharging the work in the office. Why he has to go to the office? Why he has to discharge the duties in the office? Why can't he do in the home? Because if he sit in the home, the feeding purpose of the family members will become unbearable or cumbersome. That means he cannot bear the cost of feeding the money. He cannot feed at all. But when he go to office, he works there for a specific time. He is going to get an income for doing the duty, and he is going to get that income to feed the family members and to satisfy the wants and needs of the family members. So that one reason we have to be busy. Example, you take student. A student will be always busy in studying. Why the student will be busy in studying? Because he is preparing with a subject so that tomorrow when the exams are conducted, when he presents himself in that subject in the exam, he should be scoring a maximum marks in that subject. That means your motive behind learning the subject is showing or proving yourself you are a perfect person in the subject. So student will get marks in return, whereas other people who are discharging the duties will get money in return to satisfy their wants or needs. So those activities which you are undertaking yourself to satisfy your wants and needs, we will call them as a human activity. So human activity means nothing but all those activities. What are the activities which you undertake? Suppose a helper is there who is helping a building constructor in constructing the building by lifting the sand or by converting the iron rods into a molded shape. He is going to be paid price for that one. So why he is performing that activity? He is specialized in that. He is going to get income from that activity. With that income, he is going to satisfy the wants and needs of the family members as well as his desires also. So all those activities, whether you are an educated person, uneducated person, you are a professional, non-professional, or whatever may be your talent or your intelligence or your profession or whatever may be your specialized skills, support you to perform an activity which are going to direct towards satisfying your human wants will be called as human activity. So what is human activity? Human activity is nothing but all those activities which are directed towards satisfying human wants will call this as a human activity. So this will be important for your 2 marks also. They will ask, anyway, if you come across, someone will ask, what is human activity? Human activities means nothing but all those activities which you undertake or which you direct towards satisfying your basic needs or basic wants, we'll call that as a human activity. Whether you are a skilled person, unskilled person, or whether you you are a businessman, non-businessman, you are a professional, non-professional, whether you are a student or whether you are a learner or whatever it may be, what all those activities which you undertake, which will satisfy your want. Want means nothing but a capacity of a commodity to satisfy your basic need. Suppose I am feeling thirsty. If I am feeling thirsty, I have two options. I can drink water or I can go to a cool drink shop and I have a cool drink. But I will get water free of cost. I can satisfy my desire of water with just a glass of water. But same water which is called as cool drink, when it is put in a bottle and sold in the market, to consume that cool drink, I have to pay money for that. So the desire, I cannot satisfy my want with a glass of water, I want for the cool drink. So to complete my want, to satisfy my desire, I have to pay the price for that cool drink and I should drink that cool drink. Then my want will be satisfied. So human beings will have lot of wants. Wants ante korikalu, telugulo we will call it as a desires of korikalu. Oka korika teerina tarvata inko korika place teesukuntundi. Kani aa korikalu teerchetandu manam evaithe activities we are going to put in that, we will call it as human activities. Okay, next one, that human activities are divided into two parts. A human activity, that means to satisfy your wants, desires or needs, you are going to do two things. Either you will be doing or undertaking economically, that means anything which you undertake or any activity which you undertake with an intention or with an object of earning money, we will call that as an economic activity. Anything which you undertake or which you adopt not as a part of your profit object but with an object of serving the society or helping others or with a sympathy motive, then we will call that as a non-economic. Simple lama, aalochinchandi. Human activities ante evaithe mana manasulo ade chalaleke korikalu undeyo avi manam e vidhanga satisfy cheyalo daniki elanti manam activities perform chestamo dani manam human activities antunnam. When you call it as a human activity, adi rendu vidhala untadi. Okati endante maniki sambandhinchindi, we will call that as a economical activity. And those activities which you undertake or those activities where you think of earning money in return for performing the job or in return for doing some work, we will call it as an economic. Ala kaakunda, if you are undertaking any activity or any type of things which are inspired to you from someone or which is coming from internal to you to serve the society without an object of profit, then it is called non-economic. Ante akkada dabbu vishayam interfere kaadu, it is only done with a service. Okay, so what is economic activity? Economic activities are nothing but which are concerned with production, distribution and exchange of goods and services. So this is also very important for your 2 marks answer. What is economic activities? Economic activities are those activities which are concerned with production, distribution and exchange of goods and services. For example, you take here, example, a manufacturer, suppose you take farmer is called as a manufacturer because he is producing rice. Farmer ni manamu manufacturer antunnamu endukante aina biyam pandistunnaru paddy fields lo. Directly when a farmer produces rice, in the field, it is called as production. That means he is manufacturing or he is putting the his skills to produce one commodity. He is producing the rice. It is production. From there, when he produces the rice, he cannot sell them directly to the customers. So in between, he will go to middlemen. We will call them as agents or distributors. Suppose if you see, when a farmer manufactures or produces, when a farmer manufactures rice, he manufactures that in the field, in the villages, from where you cannot directly go and buy the rice. So the rice will be sent to agents or distributors. Distribution channels we will call. Agents means those people who will buy the rice from the farmer in the large quantities according to the demand, and they will try to sell to those small people who are engaged in selling to directly to the customers in small quantity. Such a type of people we will call it as agents or distributors. So once you distribute, from there it will go into the hands of wholesaler, retailer. Wholesaler means who will buy the goods in a big quantity or a large quantity from middlemen, and they will maintain the stocks in the godown according to the requirement, and they will sell it to the retail person to sell it again to the customer. That is called distribution. Distribution means okola degara kelli manufacture aina vastu verola degara before consumption ayyavaru enni channels untundo entha mandi middlemen ostaro vallandarki madhyalo undi pothundi, we will call that as distribution. Ante oka vastu tayaraina tarvata adi consumer chain lo vachinta varaku entha mandi madhyalo untaro vallandarki manam distributors anta, ledante distribution channels anta. Then exchange of goods and services. Once the goods are come into the hands of wholesaler or retailer, wholesaler doesn't have a right to sell the goods directly to the consumer. Consumer ante the person who consumes the goods for his final consumption, to satisfy his wants or needs. A person who wants to consume or to satisfy his want, he has to buy the commodity. Such a person is known as a consumer. So wholesaler cannot sell the goods directly to the consumer, because always consumer wants the goods in small quantities. So he cannot sell that in the small quantity, because wholesaler ante he buys the goods from the manufacturer or producer in the large quantity, and he will sell it to the another person who is below him in the channel of distribution, who will sell directly to the customer. So we will call that as exchange of goods and services. Exchange, retailer exchanges the goods to customer with money. Followed up. Now a producer, farmer is producing rice in the field. He is supplying those rice to the middlemen. We will call it as agents or distributors or commission agents. From there the rice is moving to the wholesalers and retailers. Retailer is exchanging the rice with money. Then we call exchange of goods and services. So what is the main motive in the mind of retailer? Retailer is thinking of exchanging one commodity with another value for that commodity. Exchanging one commodity with the value of that commodity with another person, we'll call that as economic activity. So economic activity means all those activities which are concerned with production, distribution and exchange of goods and services, we will call that as economic activity. Suppose once we refresh our 10th class, we have seen one word called as barter system. Barter system. What is the barter system? Barter system means in the olden days before the invention, అంటే డబ్బులు మనము మార్కెట్ లో రాని టైంలో, వెన్ వి ఆర్ బీన్ హ్యాబిచువేటెడ్ ఆర్ వెన్ వి ఆర్ బీన్ యూజింగ్ ఇన్ అవర్ రెగ్యులర్ లైఫ్ మెటల్స్ కాయిన్స్ ఆర్ అదర్ టైప్ ఆఫ్ థింగ్స్ ఫర్ ద ఎక్స్చేంజ్ ఆఫ్ కమోడిటీ, వి కాల్ దట్ సిస్టమ్ యాజ్ ఎ బార్టర్ సిస్టమ్. నౌ వి హ్యావ్ పేపర్ కరెన్సీ, మెటల్ కరెన్సీ, లిక్విడ్ కరెన్సీ, నోట్ కరెన్సీ, legal money we are having. So barter system is the old type of system where which was used in the time of kings and queens, one for the exchange of one commodity directly with another commodity. In place of one commodity we are exchanging another commodity, then we call it as a barter system. The direct exchange of goods and services is known as barter system. Suppose if you are having a rice, if you are exchanging the rice with another person for pulses or sugar or oil, then it is called as a barter system. But this is not the period of king, queen or any other time. This is the modern India where we have invented a money, where we have decided the value for the commodity what you have produced. You have fixed price for every work what you have put in the production of goods and services. That's why we are calling it as economic activity. Economic activity means what? Activities which are concerned with the production, distribution and exchange of goods and services with a profit motive, we will call that as economic activity. Follow? Next one in our chart is non-economic activity. Non-economic activity means, here we have seen economic activity. Economic activity means where the involvement of money is there in exchanging goods with another person, then we will call that as economic activity. That means when you are undertaking any activity where you are going to see some benefit in terms of money, we'll call economic activity. Non-economic means you are being undertaking any type of service or any type of activity with love, affection, patriotism, religions or sympathy, or with communalism or towards the development of commerce or trade, then we will call that as non-economic. This is also very important for your 2 marks. What is non-economic activity? Those activities which are inspired by love, patriotism, sympathy, religion, etc. We will call that as a non-economic activity. Where one person is undertaking to serve the society with service motive but not with profit motive. Example, you take again here. Mother. Regularly in a home, mother will wake up in the morning, she will cook the food, she will wash the clothes, utensils, she will tie the food tiffin box, prepares the tiffin box, she will give to father, children, everyone. She will be engaged from morning to night till she go to the bed with one work or other work in order to facilitate the smooth functioning of the activities in the family. So we are not going to pay salary or we are not going to give any type of return benefit to the mother for undertaking such activity. She is doing that with love, affection, towards the upliftment of the family. She is bound to do such activities because it is her part of the duty. Such an activity is called as non-economical activity. You all know better Mother Teresa. Mother Teresa has come from the foreign country. She has settled in her area. She has seen the sufferings of those people, orphanages, blind people, those children who don't have mother, father. They want someone to help in the case of food, clothes and other things. She has been attracted towards those things and she sacrificed her property, life and all the enjoyments in the life to the betterment of orphanage or betterment of society in our India. Then we will call that as towards the patriotism or towards the love of a nation. Like that only patriotism. If you are undertaking any type of activity on the 15th August or 26th of January, by showing your love towards the nation, we will call that as a patriotism, sympathy, religion and all this. This is called as economic activity, non-economic activities. So all these three definitions are very important for your 2-2 marks scoring weightage. Next one, we are going to study in detail now what is economic activities, in how many types it has been scattered. So we have profession, employment and business. So economical activities are further divided into three types. We divide them into profession, employment and business. So we will see in detail what is mean by profession, what is mean by employment and what is mean by business. Profession. Profession means when one person is being serving the society with a service motive, who has gained expertised knowledge, skills and experience in the academics, what he has achieved in his life or in his academic year or in his academic preparations under the university level, we will call such people as a profession. Example, we will take chartered accountants, company secretaries, lawyers, doctors. These people will be called as profession. Once again, I will explain what is profession. Profession means nothing but rendering of services by those people who have gained expertise, knowledge, expertise, skills, experience and who has gained a certificate under the university level in a particular subject or in area. They are called as professionals. They will render the service in a such area in which they are proficient. They have a professional knowledge. They are going to serve the society by rendering their service. They will charge the fees for rendering the service, but it is only a nominal one, not a profitable one. So those people who have become professionals will be called as a profession. They will be counted as a profession under the head profession. Such people will be chartered accountants. Chartered accountants means those people who have completed the graduation according to the Chartered Accountancy Act of 1949, we will call them as a CA. These people are special, having a specialized skills in all the fields of accountancy, like economics, like accounting, income tax, civics, maths, law, management, auditing, secretarial practice, etc. They are supposed to guide the business people what is good, what is bad, how to write the books of accounts, how to use the law in the required place while writing the books of accounts, while filling the returns to the government, at the time of paying the taxes to the government, and how to maintain the records, documents will be done by chartered accountants. Company secretary, a person who is representing the company in all the legal matters, we will call him as a company secretary. A company secretary is the person who has passed a company secretary exam according to the Company Secretaries Act of 1969, who is a legal representative of a company in all the legal matters. Because when we talk about a company, we will be discussing what is the role of company secretary there. But now, for the time being, a legal representative of the company in all the legal matters is supposed to be represented. Okay, then lawyers, you know lawyer. Lawyer is a person who is going to protect his clients from defending the legal matters. At the time of defending the legal matters, that means guiding you in legal aspects of your life. If you have committed any type of offense, or if you have committed any type of mistake, or if you have committed any type of fraud, or any type of cheating, or any type of unlawful activity is done by you, then lawyer is a person who is going to help you in protecting your fundamental right. Doctors. Doctors are those people who are going to help you in maintaining your good health. Any type of bodily problems, any type of disorders, any type of the problems going to arise in your body, we will approach to the doctor. Doctor is going to give the prescribed medicine. From where he is going to give you the prescribed medicine, how he is going to guide you how to become a healthy person, the academics what he has studied, the experience what he has taken at the time of doing his graduation or post graduation in a particular subject, the skills what he has gained in a subject will help him to guide you or give you the prescription. These people will be called as a professionals. They are going to serve the society with a service objective. They don't have a profit motive in their mind, but they will charge the fees from the clients, those who are approaching them. But nominal fees will be taken, not high fees. Then comes to employment. Employment means it is a example, A is there, B is there, A is called owner, B is called employee. A is having a shop. A is there, B is there. A is called as a owner of the shop. He is having a shop. Some shop is there. B is an employee. So there is an agreement between one person with another person to work. B is agreed to work with A in his shop, for which A also given his acceptance or permission. So the agreement drawn between the owner and employee, or we can also call employer and employee as an agreement, employment agreement. According to that agreement, A should provide the required job which can be done by the B according to his capacity, and employee should work according to the guidelines, according to the skills according to his knowledge and make him in a profitable position. According to the punctuality, according to the time. Whatever the work given by A should be done by B. And whatever the work is done by B, for that A should pay price to the another person. The agreement formed between these two people makes these people as an employer and employee. In other words, we can also call them old boss, servant, boss, servant, or principal, agent. Okay? Now the third one, we will see business. So we will start with business in the next class, because business is a lengthier one. So we will discuss the definition of the business in the next class, and along with the characteristics, objectives of the business in the next class. So kindly listen to my class and get involved.